Page number 14 of today's newspaper brings to forth an important topic from the perspective of China and India. It talks about study on China dam bring the Brahmaputra into focus. Now, as far as topic is concerned, this topic is important from the perspective of General Studies Paper 2, mains, and it is important from the perspective of India and its neighborhood. Now, there is a huge geopolitical significance of Brahmaputra as a river. And for this, we need to understand the map. Now, you can see here, India is being highlighted here. At the same time, on the north of India, there is China. This particular river, which flows parallel to Nepal, then to Sikkim, then Bhutan, and ultimately enters to Great Bends of Yarlang into India, is called as Brahmaputra and is called Yarlang Tsangpo in China. Also important here is to understand that we have identified three important locations. These locations are important because three dams are being built on this river. One is Jigsu, second is Zagmu, and third is Zaicha. So these dams are very important from the perspective of coming prelims examination as well, and you should be very clear about their location and the river. Now, coming back to the importance of geopolitical significance of Brahmaputra as a river, we need to understand that this river is important for both India and China. In this context, we know that China supports around 20% of the world population. At the same time, India supports around 17% of the world population. Another notable factor is, whenever we talk about the distribution of natural resources, when we talk about China, China has around 7% of fresh water. At the same time, when we talk about India, India has around 4% of fresh water reserves globally. Now, the factor of being the geopolitical significance comes into picture because China has an ambitious plan to triple its hydropower capacity. And since China has already built dams on its rivers, it is increasingly damming transboundary rivers to achieve its hydropower targets. Now, this problem is actually increased many folds over because China intends to undertake gigantic water diversion projects, which include building a dam on the Great Bends of Yarlang. Now, from the perspective of the prelims examination, it is important for you to know that at the location of Great Bend of Yarlang, the river curves into Assamese plain of India, and when we talk about Brahmaputra or Yarlang Tsangpo, enters India after passing the Great Bend through Arunachal Pradesh, where it is known as Siang or Dihang, and then on to Assam, where it is called as Brahmaputra, and thereafter in Bangladesh, where it is named as Jamuna. Now, in this context, it is important to understand what kind of advantage China enjoys in terms of being the upper riparian state. Now, let's first try to understand what is the meaning of upper riparian. When we call a particular country as upper riparian, it means the upper course of river, which may also include the origin of river, lies in that country. Now, when we talk about this particular issue, China is completely upper riparian, which lends it an unparalleled advantage and power to influence the flow of water to nations in downstream. India functions as a middle riparian state. But when we talk about Pakistan or Bangladesh, India acts as a upper riparian state. Now, this brings us to an important question. What kind of advantage upper riparian state offers to the country where the river originates? It is normally seen that upper riparian state claim on the principle of absolute territorial sovereignty, which means that right to use river water unilaterally regardless of lower riparian concerns. At the same time, we also need to know about the lower riparian states. The lower riparian states base their claim on the absolute territorial integrity. So please try to understand. Upper riparian states claim absolute territorial sovereignty, and lower riparian states talk about absolute territorial integrity, which argues that upper riparian actions should not affect the water flowing downstream. Now, the kind of advantage that China enjoys because of the factor of Tibet. China is in distinctive position as a completely upper riparian nation, allows it to act as a hydro hegemon in the region. China's hydro hegemony is made possible by its control over Tibet. The Qingshai Tibetan Plateau extend over vast area spanning 2.5 million square kilometers and is often referred to as third pole or the roof of the world. Another distinct feature of this particular area is that this is the home to the largest freshwater reserves outside North and South Poles. It is also the source of some of the Asia's most important river system, which includes Indus, Ganges, Brahmaputra, Irrawaddy, Slavin, Mekong, Yangtze, and Huange. At the same time, all these rivers are transboundary in nature, with an exception of Yangtze and Huange. Now let's try to focus on the Chinese hydropower projects, which are important for the perspective of India as well. Now in this context, we need to understand that China has completed Zhangmu Dam. This dam is located on the upper reaches of Brahmaputra in 2010. Now why this particular thing is important? That China accepted construction of Zhangmu Dam only in 2010. It is needless to say that they started constructing this dam much before than that. It actually means what? It means that China has not officially communicated anything about the construction of this dam, that is Zhangmu Dam, and other three dams that we have talked about in terms of Dagu, Laicha and Jigsu, and these are again on Brahmaputra. At the same time, they are also building Zam hydropower station, which will be the largest dam on Brahmaputra. So this brings us to the very important aspect of this entire debate. The debate roots from one particular thing, that China is the upper riparian state and hence it has a right to use this water. At the same time, China should also consider the need of other countries which are lower riparian state, which includes India, Bangladesh and many other countries like Myanmar, etc. But the point is, China has been very selfish in its approach and hence China has built more dams on its river than the rest of the world combined. At the same time, what is more appalling is that China does not have any kind of water sharing agreement or treaty with any of its neighbors, which includes India as well. Many of you would recall that there is Indus Water Treaty between India and Pakistan, through which India shares its water with Pakistan. At the same time, similar kind of arrangement for so many rivers that travel from China to India is not there or is absent altogether. Another problem is, as already mentioned, China behaves in a very self-centered manner and hence there is lack of communication by China in terms of construction of dam, and this has led to an atmosphere of suspicion and mistrust in India, especially in its northeastern region. China has indicated that three hydropower projects on the main stream of Brahmaputra River in Tibet Autonomous Region were approved for implementation. At the same time, it is important for China as a country that it should bring other countries on the platform as well in terms of debate and discussion, in terms of what their needs are and how it can be fulfilled. So this brings us to the important aspect of what are India's concern in terms of the kind of dams China has been building in the recent past. As a lower riparian state with considerable established user right to the waters of the transborder rivers, India carefully monitors all developments on the Brahmaputra River. Government has consistently conveyed its views and concern to Chinese authorities and has urged them to ensure that the interests of downstream states are not harmed by the activities of the upstream area. Now, it is important here to highlight that whenever such issues being raised, Chinese side has conveyed that they have only undertaken run-of-the-river hydropower project. It means that these kind of hydropower projects do not involve diversion of water of the Brahmaputra. At the same time, India's concern is that these dams are large enough to be converted and used as storage dams. China is depriving India of water during lean season is also a possibility in this case, and this gives China an advantage to arm twist India. Another important features of these hydropower projects which are established by China is that when they release water during the monsoon season, it can actually inundate the already flooded Brahmaputra River basin in Assam. There is much apprehension that Brahmaputra may lose silt, which makes the plain in its basin fertile because of the sediments being trapped in the dams. So we can see there are two kinds of problem. First, there is lack of communication and hence lack of predictability, and in this sense, this has led to lack of trust as well in terms of Chinese intentions. We all are aware of the fact that the Himalayan region is highly tectonic region as well. Most of the hydropower projects are located in these regions, and it is a possibility that some tectonic activity might disrupt these hydropower projects, and this may lead to drowning of lakhs and lakhs of people in the lower riparian states. All hydropower projects, particularly around the Great Bend, are located in a highly volatile tectonic zone. Their proximity makes them extremely earthquake prone. Another important aspect that has emerged from this particular scenario is the pollution of rivers. In building its dam, China has also polluted its rivers. The quality of water that flows downstream into India needs to be taken into account. The disruption of natural flood cycles of the rivers could also adversely affect the rich geo-environmental and biophysical settings in India's northeastern part. Another concern that India shares is the principle of prior appropriation. Now, please try to understand what the principle of prior appropriation means. What it does that it protects the right of first use of water as in the past. China has the priority right since it is the first to build dam on Yarlung Tsangpo. And it means that Indian interests are not being protected through this principle of appropriation. Another important concern of India is the claim of China on Arunachal Pradesh. By building dams, especially near to Great Bend, after which the river flows into India through Arunachal Pradesh, China could be seeking to leverage its claim over Indian state of Arunachal Pradesh. So these are few concerns that India has raised in terms of Chinese hydropower project. This brings us to the third aspect of discussion, and that is India's approach to handle Chinese hegemony in case of rivers. Now, in this context, it is important for you to know that India too has decided to commence construction of 14 hydropower projects in Arunachal Pradesh. These projects will be located on lower down on Brahmaputra, and this might be viewed as India's effort to establish its lower riparian right to counter China's first use priority rights. At the same time, there is an issue of caution as well, as some of the projects like Lower Subansiri Hydroelectric Power Project are stuck in red tape. We need to develop a credible policy and implement that within the established framework so that we get maximum benefit from this policy. Now, there is another aspect that we need to understand in terms of the kind of precipitation that is received by Brahmaputra River. The kind of precipitation is received either in the form of snowfall or in the form of rainfall. Now, please try to understand that the volume of precipitation varies across Brahmaputra's sub-basin substantially. It receives snowfall primarily in the Tibetan part, and when we talk about rainfall, this is received primarily in the northeastern part of India. What it actually highlights that the kind of unpredictability that we are assuming in terms of flow of water in Brahmaputra is actually much less than what we are fearing of. And this is also proven by the third aspect. The total annual outflow of Yarlung in China is about 31 billion cubic meters, while the annual flow of Brahmaputra at the end of sub-basin in Bangladesh is around 606 billion cubic meters. It simply implies one fact that 80% of the flows of Brahmaputra emerge within the Indian boundary, and hence the problem can be easily managed if India maintains projects on Brahmaputra rivers. This particular thing is also highlighted that Brahmaputra also gets mightier if it flows downstream within India because of the flow and contribution of tributaries such as Dibang, Lohit and Subansiri. Now, the point that we wish to highlight is the kind of quantum jump in terms of water flow in Brahmaputra normally takes place within the Indian subcontinent, and that too within the territory of India. And hence, this problem is easily manageable. Apart from these, various issues relating to transborder rivers are discussed with China under the ambit of institutionalized expert level mechanism, which was established in 2006. Apart from these, other diplomatic channels are also being utilized. In this context, it is important for us to know that Bangladesh as a lower riparian state has supported India's position of pressurizing China on forming a river sharing agreement. Similarly, India can work with other lower riparian countries of river originating from China, such as Mekong, to end the hydro hegemony of China. So in this case, we can see that we have many solutions available, and what we need to do is to implement our approach in the right perspective so that we can put enough pressure on China, and China will definitely yield. Page number 11 of today's newspaper presents an interview of Syed Akbaruddin. Mr. Akbaruddin, who has been India's permanent representative to United States since many years, is about to retire. Now, one of the consistent demands from India is to make the United States Security Council more democratic in nature. And hence, there is a continuous debate of India's case for permanent membership. This particular issue of India's permanent seat in Security Council has been very important from the perspective of UPSC examination. Now, in the current context, it is very important because India is due for elections to the temporary membership of UNSC later this year for the period of 2021 to 22. So, this discussion is very important from the perspective of coming examination. and it has impact both for prelims as well as for mains. Now we have seen that in today's newspaper, the weight was too much on international affairs, and this topic will again fall for international relations and international organizations. Now in this context, let's first understand what is UNSC or United Nations Security Council. The United Nations Security Council is the principal crisis management body and is empowered to impose binding obligations on the 193 member states to maintain peace. Here it is important for you to understand that there are two aspects. First and foremost, it can impose binding obligations on all the member countries. And second, the purpose of these binding obligations is to maintain peace. It is needless to say that whatever United Nations Security Council passes, it becomes binding on all members, that is 193 members, which is the current strength of the United Nations. So, in a nutshell, what are the roles of UNSC? First and foremost, as already mentioned, ensuring international peace and security. Second important aspect is recommending that General Assembly accept new members to the United Nations. And third, which is very important, and that is approving any changes to its charter. What it means that no changes to the United Nations charter or no new members can be admitted into UN without the approval of United Nations Security Councils. At the same time, these resolutions require agreement of all P5 or the permanent members. In terms of permanent members, there are five. These are USA, Russia, UK, France, and China. These are called as P5 members or permanent members. Apart from that, there are 10 non-permanent members as well, which are elected for a period of 2 years. And in this context, there is continent-wise quota as well. Africa will choose 3 countries, Asia will choose 2 countries, Latin America will choose 2 countries, Western Europe and others will choose 2 countries, and Eastern Europe will choose 1 country. This is how the rest of the 10 seats are basically filled. So this brings us to the next important aspect. What is the structure of United Nations Security Council? The Security Council structure has 2 parts. First is the permanent member, and second is 10 non-permanent members. As already mentioned, when we talk about the permanent members or P5, these include China, France, Russia, the United Kingdom, and the United States of America. They have a special power available to them, and they have the power to veto. Any one of them can veto a resolution. Now let's try to understand what is the meaning of veto. It means if any one of them opposes a proposal or vetoes it, then the resolution cannot be passed by United Nations Security Council. So in this sense, all these 5 countries become very important, and they basically start defining the destiny of 193 member countries. Now we have also highlighted that there are 10 non-permanent members as well, but they are not at par with other members of Security Council. At the same time, these are basically elected on the basis of geographical reasons. At the same time, their position is temporary in nature, and they have a tenure of just 2 years. Another defining element for non-permanent members is that these members do not have any kind of veto powers. Now let's try to understand why the power of veto was installed in this particular organization at the very first place. The United States and the Soviet Union were the outright victors of the World War II, and along with the United Kingdom, they shaped the post-war political order. Since these countries were dominant in nature, and hence they bestowed themselves with the power of veto. And this is how Security Council became that powerful in the current context. So how are these non-permanent members elected to the Security Council? These 10 non-permanent members are elected by United Nations General Assembly for a period of 2 years. This normally starts from 1st of January with 5 replaced each year. To be approved, a candidate country must receive at least 2/3 of all the votes cast for that seat, which can result in deadlock if there are 2 roughly evenly matched candidates. At the same time, you should also remember that a retiring member is not eligible for immediate re-election. So now let's try to understand how these meetings of United Nations Security Council are being conducted. The Council's presidency rotates on a monthly basis. The mechanism ensures that even non-permanent members can also play some role in the agenda setting. Now, in this context, there are few things that you should keep in mind for the purpose of examination. And in this context, Chapter 6 of United Nations Charter is very important for you. It clearly mentions The Security Council aims to peacefully resolve international disputes under Chapter 6 of the United Nations, which authorizes the Council to call on parties to seek solutions via negotiation, arbitration, or other peaceful means. From the purpose of the coming examination, you need to focus. It has been highlighted that negotiation, arbitration, or other peaceful means are the first point of resort for the United Nations Security Council. However, there are chances that these may fail as well. In this context, Chapter 7 of United Nations Charter also comes into picture, which empowers the Security Council to take more assertive actions. Now, when we talk about assertive action, it means imposing sanctions or authorizing the use of force to maintain or restore international peace and security. Please remember, sanctions as well as force both are part of assertive actions for which United Nations Security Council is empowered with. Peacekeeping missions are the most visible face of United Nations conflict management work, and in mid-2018, following the completion of its mission in Liberia, the Council was overseeing 14 operations involving roughly 90,000 uniformed personnel. So we can see that how strong United Nations Security Council is. So in this fashion, we can see that for the purpose of maintaining international peace and security, even force and sanctions both are being recommended by the United Nations. Now let's move towards the stand of India in terms of getting a permanent seat at UNSC. Now let us try to understand the justification for India's candidature as a permanent member at the United Nations Security Council. There are two aspects which are very important from the perspective of India, and first is the protection of national interest. Now if India is the member of United Nations Security Council as a permanent member, it will get veto power, which India could use to defend its interest, say against Pakistan. We have seen that Russia has done a similar kind of activity in terms of protection of interest in terms of its war with Ukraine. Second important aspect is India is the largest democratic country in the world. And when we talk about the UN, UN has certainly promoted the agenda of democracy. So it is quite pertinent that India, which is the largest democracy, should be represented in the institution which has accepted democracy as one of the best ways to govern a country. And hence, if India gets its membership, the sheer prestige associated with permanent membership of a multilateral forum, India's elevation will also be an acknowledgement of its rise as a global power. Apart from that, India has played key role in Council's objective of international peace and security. And in this context, following points are very important. Now, the first point that goes in India's favor is the population itself. India's population is going to touch 1.4 billion soon, and in this context, we will represent 1/6 of the humanity. United Nations Security Council should respect the status of India and should accept her into the United Nations Security Council. Second important aspect is the strength of democratic institutions in India. India has unique distinction of continuous and functional democratic experience. India is best suited to provide these values in the United Nations Security Council, which is often criticized for acting on behalf of just few nations. Third important aspect is economy itself. India is also world's fifth largest economy and the third largest in terms of purchasing power parity as of 2020. Even if we talk about militarily, India is a responsible nuclear power, and India's expense on military is third largest in the world after China and USA. The unique distinction of India being a large country, India being a democratic country, India being a robust economy, and India being a military superpower are enough to support India's candidature in the United Nations Security Council. Apart from that, India's participation in the United Nations agencies is nothing but exemplary in nature. India is the largest contributor to the United Nations peacekeeping operations, with nearly 180,000 troops serving in 44 missions since it was established. Apart from that, India is also among the highest financial contributors to the UN, with country making regular donations to several United Nations organs. Moreover, if we talk about regionally as well, India's participation in global affairs is no less than any of the superpowers. India has not only participated, but has taken lead roles in matters which are global, like climate change, ozone depletion, counterterrorism, and rule-based global order. In this sense, we can see that India's candidature is in line with the basic spirit of United Nations. United Nations as an organization claims to be representing peoples of this world. And in this context, India's position should not be denied any further. पेज नंबर 6 ऑफ टुडेज न्यूज़पेपर टॉक्स अबाउट अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक ऑफ करंट टाइम दैट इज अफगान पीस एंड इंडियाज एल्बो रूम. Now, as far as this topic is concerned, this topic is important more from the perspective of General Studies Paper 2, that is mains. As a subtopic, it is important from the perspective of India and its neighborhood. Now, we are aware of the fact that US has recently got into a deal with Taliban to ensure peace process between Taliban and Afghanistan government. One of the primary benefits of this peace deal is that US will be in a position to withdraw from the Afghan soil. However, it has normally been understood that US has entered into this deal because of hurry to withdraw from the Afghanistan soil. And since US was in hurry, it actually imposed peace deal on the Ashraf Ghani government. It also seems very plausible that in this entire peace deal, Taliban would be the ultimate winner in this entire scheme of things. At the same time, India also needs to recalibrate its position in context of Afghanistan. However, there are many things that have happened in the recent past which actually questioned the position of India in this entire peace deal. In this context, author has highlighted one very important aspect. UN Secretariat has held 6+2+1 meeting on regional efforts to support the peace in Afghanistan. Now, as far as the participating countries are concerned, the six neighbors of Afghanistan, which include China, Iran, Pakistan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan were invited. Two global players, which included the USA and Russia, were also invited. And one is Afghanistan, which attended the meeting. Now, in this context, we can see that absence of India from this meeting is a serious blow to India's effort to bring peace in the civil war-torn Afghanistan. At the same time, it is also very important for us to understand that India presents itself as one of the leaders of South Asia. Afghanistan being part of South Asia, and hence India's presence in this entire scheme was more of an assumed truth. At the same time, when India is not invited into this meeting, it means that we need to channelize our diplomatic efforts in the right direction so that the good work that India has done with the Afghanistan government in last 20 years are not compromised. But before moving further, let's try to understand why India was not invited in the meeting. It is said that India does not share physical boundary with Afghanistan. Now, many of you will feel otherwise that India shares a physical boundary with Afghanistan. At the same time, the physical boundary that India shares with Afghanistan falls under Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. And hence, this was given as one of the reasons that Pakistan was invited, but at the same time, India was not invited for this meeting. However, the author highlights that the real reason for India being not invited in this meeting is that India has never announced its support for the US-Taliban peace process. As we are already aware, US is very clear to withdraw from Afghan soil, and in this context, they want those people on board who basically support this process. Through this peace deal, what US has ensured that Afghanistan will not attack on US and NATO-led forces. At the same time, the number of soldiers who are present in Afghanistan would be reduced to just 8,500. So we can see that US has already brokered a deal in which they want to move out and move out as much as possible and as fast as possible. And hence, any kind of an interruption into this process is not going to get accepted. And that is what has happened in this case as well. Third important aspect is India has never treated Taliban as a political entity. At the same time, there are other problems as well. What these other problems are, first and foremost, Taliban is supported by Pakistan. Moreover, India sees emergence of Taliban as one of the primary reasons for the promotion of terrorism in the Indian mainland. And hence, India has shown resistance to the idea that it should publicly talk with Taliban. Now, consider the situation. If India would have been invited in this meeting and they're not willing to participate in talks with Taliban, then this would have made the meeting a failure at the very first step. And hence, this could also be one of the reasons why India was not invited in this meeting. Last important part is that even Ashraf Ghani government is not leading the process of this peace negotiation or deal. Now, this topic becomes important for a simple reason that India has invested in democratic government of Ashraf Ghani. We as a country has supported many efforts which include police, law and order, health facility, infrastructure, roads, and many other aspects. In this context, the goodwill relationship between countries of India and Afghanistan has led to positive results in the diplomatic front. However, what is problematic is that Ashraf Ghani government is not actively participating in this entire process of peace deal with Taliban. This peace deal is actually imposed by US on the people of Afghanistan, and Ashraf Ghani government is not in favor of talking to Taliban. The reason for this is very simple. Taliban does not accept Ashraf Ghani government as a democratically elected government. Moreover, if these talks succeed, then there will be problem for Ashraf Ghani government, because Taliban will come to power and Ashraf Ghani, who is a democratically chosen leader, will be out of power. In such a scenario, even great relationship between India and Ashraf Ghani government of Afghanistan is not going to help India's cause in being a partner in this peace negotiation or deal. So this brings us to the very important aspect where we stand today. Now, it is no denying that India's voice in this reconciliation process, that is the peace process between the Taliban and Afghanistan government, has been very limited. Another very significant aspect is that it has weakened India's position with other leaders of deeply divided democratic setup in Kabul. Now, you must be aware of the fact that one of the participants of the democratic government, Ashraf Ghani government, Mr. Abdullah Abdullah, has threatened to move out of government and to start a parallel government. This means the problem that we are facing is at multifolds. First, the kind of democratic powers which are there in Afghanistan, they are not on the same plank. And second, India's weight in South Asia, and especially in the case of Afghanistan peace process, has been compromised to a great extent. In this context, it is important for us to understand how bad the situation is for India. Now, first and foremost, as already mentioned, India's participation with the democratically elected Ashraf Ghani government is very high. We have invested huge amounts of money, which runs in billions of dollars, in Afghanistan, and all this investment that India has done in the recent past will come to zero. Moreover, what can be worse for India is that Taliban comes to power and the problem of terror goes up in the South Asian subcontinent. We have seen that situation has become much worse, especially in the recent past, when we talk about groups like ISKP, which is Islamic State of Khorasan Province, which is a terrorist organization backed by Pakistan, and it attacked Gurdwara in Kabul, which killed 25 Sikhs. Now, the kind of retaliation we see on Afghan soil against India is one of the problems that we want to address at the very first place. So, the entire effort of Indian government in terms of maintaining better relationship with Afghanistan, supporting the democratic measures, at the same time participating in the development process, will come to a standstill. Now, we need to also understand what has gone against India's favor in the recent past as well. Now, we are aware of the fact that India has recently passed Citizenship Amendment Act. In this case, we know that India has given an opportunity to persecuted minorities from countries like Pakistan, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, etc. In this case, we have seen that Afghanistan has expressed its strong reservation against India's policy on Citizenship Amendment Act. It clearly mentioned that the kind of atrocities that we have seen against minorities, especially Hindus, in Afghanistan were during the regime of Taliban. And since now there is a democratic government in power, there is no such problem for which India should be worried. But at the same time, this has damaged India's goodwill as a secular country, and hence, at the international platform, India's position is little weakened to handle such kind of issues. So this brings us to the next part of discussion. What can be done to salvage the situation for India? Now, the first thing that we need to do is to showcase to the world that India's usability in this entire peace process is very high. And one of the simplest way to ensure this is to act as a bridge between Ashraf Ghani government and parallel government of Abdullah Abdullah, to showcase that India's role in Afghanistan is significant and cannot be neglected in any case. Second important aspect, which is very important for US as well, India should act as a mediation channel between the US and Iran. We are aware of the fact that US and Iran have unsettled issues. At the same time, India's relationship with Iran are very good. Whether we talk about purchase of oil and gas or Chabahar port, India and Iran have been on good terms for quite a significant period of time, and hence India should utilize this opportunity to show US that India's clout is not only limited to Afghanistan but to the entire region and beyond. The last thing that author wants to highlight, that because of the coronavirus pandemic and also because of the problem that we have seen in Afghanistan, many consulate offices in Afghanistan are closed, and hence what India needs to do is to appoint special envoy in order to deal with its effort in Afghanistan. What we need to ensure is a strong and continuous presence in Afghanistan. This kind of special envoy will ensure that there is diplomatic agility and a firmness of purpose at the watershed moment in that country's history. Now, it is needless to highlight that relationship between India and Afghanistan goes back for centuries. And it is not only diplomacy, but history, art, culture, and many other facets of Afghanistan are related with India. At the same time, what we require that Afghanistan should remain India's friend and not a hotbed for terrorist activities. Page number 7 of today's newspaper highlights an important news which talks about a greater impact on women. The subtopic further explains that COVID-19 poses a threat to women's livelihood as well as increase their burden at home as well. In this context, this topic is important more from the perspective of social issue and will relate to women affairs. Now, we are aware of the fact that COVID-19 pandemic is exposing inequalities of all kinds, which includes gender inequality as well. In this case, we have seen that many kind of social problems have emerged, especially after lockdown has been implemented, and this has been seen globally all across the world. In the first case, we have seen that there has been increase in the domestic violence. After the lockdown has been imposed, all countries have seen that there has been a tremendous increase in the domestic violence. In this case, the largest support organization, the UK, has reported that there is 700% increase in the calls, indicating a surge in the domestic violence. In this case, women and children both are at the receiving end of this domestic violence. At the same time, since lockdown is continuing for a long period of time, there seems to be little respite for the people who are suffering these kind of problems. Second important aspect that got highlighted is that more women in poorly paid jobs. Now, it is a common fact that women at times are related to pink collar jobs, which at times means that women are disproportionately represented in poorly paid jobs. They basically lack benefits as domestic workers, casual laborers, and street vendors. They basically participate in jobs which do not get any kind of benefits. They are treated at par with domestic workers, casual laborers, street vendors, and in a small scale service like hairdressing. If we go by the estimates of International Labour Organization, it says that nearly 200 million jobs will be lost in the next 3 months alone. And there is no denying from the fact that these will be from those sectors we have just mentioned. That is, casual laborers, domestic workers, street vendors, etc. Third important aspect that we have highlighted in the recent past is limited opportunity for girl child education. And when we talk about this particular scenario, this has been happening in most of the third world countries. The author highlights in some of the villages of Sierra Leone, school enrollment rates for teenage girls fell from 50% to 34% after the Ebola epidemic, with lifelong implications for their well-being and that their communities and societies. We need to understand that whenever we take away education from a particular child, even from a girl, then we actually put these children into the vicious cycle of poverty. And it has been observed that to come out of this poverty is not an easy task in any sense. Last point that we have highlighted in terms of impact on women is delay in women's return to the paid labor force. Now, we need to understand the kind of impact that this COVID-19 had. Many kind of jobs will be difficult to find. In this sense, we know that huge increase in care work due to school closure, increased needs for elderly people, these women will not be in a position to get back to their main jobs again. And this is going to affect their ability to earn. At the same time, as and when they are willing to join jobs, they will not get as much as they were getting earlier. So it becomes quite clear that there are various kinds of impact on women. First is domestic violence. Second is poorly paid jobs in the unorganized sector. Third is limited opportunity for girl child education. And last but not the least, as and when COVID-19 pandemic comes to an end, there will be a delay for these women folks to go back to their jobs. Now, in this sense, it is important for us to know that what kind of steps are required to tackle the situation. Now, we are aware of the fact that some of the major problems that women have faced is all about domestic violence and loss of paid jobs. In this context, it is important for us to maintain that moving services like women counseling, etc., should be made online. We know that we are in a state of a lockdown and it is difficult to maintain the quality of services, even to reach out to the people. And hence, online system of providing service is one sure shot mechanism that the problem of these women is basically addressed. Next important aspect is that we know that the kind of domestic violence women are facing, we need to expand domestic violence shelters and designating them as an essential. Now, it is important to understand that whenever we are trying to fight a problem, we need to think holistically. Counseling is one part of the entire scheme. The second important aspect is to give them alternate as well. In this context, expanding domestic violence shelters is a very important aspect and cannot be missed. Third is increasing support to the frontline organizations working for the women. If we see in the current context, the focus is primarily on the healthcare. At the same time, the kind of issues women and children are facing, they cannot be neglected in long run. And hence, we need to increase the support of frontline organizations working for women welfare. Next important aspect is that we need to fight against the stigma of pink collar jobs. Women basically require secure jobs and not insecure jobs, and basically require all kind of protection which normally people get in organized sector. In this case, basic social protection, which includes health insurance, two paid sick leaves, child care, income protection and unemployment benefits, should also be extended for the women. Last but not the least, measures to stimulate economy should be taken, and cash transfers, credits, loans and bailout must be targeted at women. In this context, we can say that the kind of PM Garib Kalyan Yojana that Government of India has implemented, this focus has been maintained that these kind of benefits are directly transferred to women's account. Now, author basically goes on to suggest what initiative or steps can be taken in order to ensure faster recovery from the pandemic. And in this case, the first suggestion is actually very important. We know that women's contribution in GDP is basically underrated. And that is what the author has highlighted. Women's unpaid domestic labor is subsidizing both public services and private profits. And hence, what is the need right now? The need is to ensure that this particular contribution is included in the economic metrics and decision making. Now, the point is why such an initiative is required. Now, we have a tendency to stereotype the kind of jobs women perform in terms of pink collar jobs. And at times, these pink collar jobs also become a system of exploitation as well. These are underpaid as their value is not fully realized. And hence, it is important that women's contribution in terms of unpaid domestic labor is also appreciated and equated in the economics metrics. Second important aspect is, with women's interests and rights front and center, we can get through this pandemic faster. Now, we need to understand that whenever we try to talk about any kind of economic model or any kind of rehabilitation model, the focus is primarily workers. At the same time, the author's thinking is that we should make family as the point of work for any kind of rehabilitation work. When we talk about family, the focus should be on women and children. And hence, the author highlights that there is a need for women's interest to take precedence over everything else. If we do that, we can get through this pandemic faster and build more equal and resilient communities and societies that will benefit everyone. Last but not the least, we also need to democratize the institutions as well. And when we talk about democratize, we are actually focusing on the demography aspect. We need women at the table when decisions are being taken on this pandemic. To prevent worst case scenario like the second spike infection, labor shortage and even social unrest. It is needless to highlight that right now the focus is basically on healthcare and revival of economy. At the same time, we need to understand that if we protect the interest of women, both these initiatives will automatically come into picture, and this will actually ensure that we will proceed toward faster recovery from this pandemic. And hence, this particular issue is important from the perspective of social issue, as it highlights the role and importance of women in terms of fighting pandemic as well. Now let us move to the last part of discussion, and this deals with prelims pointers. Now the first news that we have discussed in today's analysis is study on China maps bring Brahmaputra in focus. Now this topic is very important for the perspective of prelims because of the dams, the rivers on which these dams are built, and next important aspect is important bends after which the river Brahmaputra enters India. At the same time, we should also know the kind of name Brahmaputra River is given in different parts. We know that it is called as Jamuna in Bangladesh, it is called as Brahmaputra in India, at the same time it is called as Tsangpo in China. So in this sense, it is important for us to know the name of the river in various parts of the world. And this could be one of the questions in the prelims as well. This topic is important and hence map work is necessary for this part. It is expected that you will go and refer to the map and see all the rivers which were discussed today. Second important article, by any calculus, India qualifies for UNSC permanent seat. Now this topic is again very important from the perspective of knowing what is United Nations Security Council, what is its organization, what is its structure, and what is the mandate of this United Nations Security Council. At the same time, you should also know Chapter 6 and Chapter 7, which deal with establishing peace and security at global level. And these are very important from the perspective of prelims. We can say that Article 1 and 2 are important more from the perspective of prelims, but at the same time, Article 3 and 4 are more important from the perspective of mains examination. Article 3 basically talks about India's position or role in South Asia and also in context of India-Afghanistan relations. Next topic, topic 4, a greater impact on COVID, talks about impact of COVID-19 on various groups. In this case, the focus has been women. There has been editorial as well which talks about strategic shift. Now this topic has been discussed many times over in the recent past and hence I have given this topic a miss. At the same time, those who want to revise this topic can go through the editorial. There is nothing new in this article and we have discussed this topic many times over in the recent past. With this, we have come to the question of the day. The question of the day reads, consider the following statements about the United Nations. Statement number 1, United Nations allows mechanism of negotiation and arbitration only for the purpose of establishment of peace. Statement 2, Chapter 7 of the United Nations Charter deals with the mechanism of establishing peace. Statement 3, all the members of Security Council enjoy veto power. Which of the statement given above is or incorrect? Option A, 1 and 3 only. Option B, 2 only. Option C, 2 and 3. And option D, 1, 2 and 3.